What up? I'm back. 9:34, 8:23. What is today? August 22. On a Tuesday. Man, time flies by when you're having fun. Dude, yeah, dude, man, time's crazy. Time is so crazy because, man, it's so crazy. And it sucks. It sucks, but it's good, man. Like, it's good. Like, time is cool. Change is amazing. I love change. I guess. I have to. Evidently. As much as I do it every fucking day. It's all I do is change. Yet, I'm still consistently me. But that's what's so crazy is... what is change? Does change even exist? Like, what is changing? I would say that external things change, kind of, sort of. They have it, you know. But not really. Like, it's consistent a lot of times. I mean, all of nature is changing. You're going through seasons every day. You're changing ideas. I'm changing ideas. I'm changing ways. I'm changing thoughts. I'm changing processes. I'm changing understandings of myself. I'm changing understandings of other people. But usually, first off, like, the understandings of other people doesn't really technically matter, because what I'm changing is I'm changing understandings of me and in me. And in that, it just means now I can accept people as they are, because I accept me as me. And giving myself so much time, attention, and focus, I came to the acceptance of me. You know, what I do, why I do it, how I do it, you know. And then I understand that if I don't go do anything about it or change, like when I change the ideas, like then what do you do there? I'm trying to think. Like, do you change your approach on other things, or are you keeping them the same? And I do in one instance, I guess. But then again, like I said, I don't know. So there's always one instance in my life. It's so crazy. But it's crazy because, like, lately I've been having dreams every single night. Like I said, and I don't talk about one set of dreams, but then I'll talk about other set of dreams. Because one set of dreams always pertains to the same thing, or the same ideas, or the same whatever. And then the other dreams pertain to something else. Certain dreams have a certain theme, and the same variables, and then the other dreams won't. And so I don't talk about those, because those are more personable to me. And like I said, I try not to talk about things that need to be private, because you still have to have a private understanding, like, life, like, even in the aspect of what I'm doing. Like I said, you know, there's a lot of things that I don't talk about because those are for me and a significant other in the future, right? Like, I can't give all my love away, even though I've given up so much, and it's part of my purpose, but I understand completely that a lot of what I've given up is what was the past version of me. This is the only reason why I'm okay with it, because even if I talk day to day about things, it tends to pertain to my past or the journey of me just learning to love myself and the things that I'm doing right now. When I'm with people in the future, when I'm with people I'm building stuff with, when I'm with, I have enough love to give them, because it's all new. It's all new experience. And so, like, me technically freely giving away what I've given, the knowledge, the wisdom, the words, whatever, the memories, the past, it's like, I gotta give it somewhere, right? I gotta speak it. And if I just speak it out to myself, which I do, like, this is why I like recording it, because now it's worth something. Now I can help somebody else, even if it sounds crazy, even if it's outrageous, even if it's dumb. Every action that I do has a purpose bigger than me. Even if it helps one person, even if everything I say is stupid, and one sentence in a 10-minute video help somebody, and not even change their life, but just help somebody. They can see it from a new perspective, or they can look at themselves and go, oh, I never looked at it that way, and then boom, that gets the ball rolling. Like, if the words that come out of my mouth can help somebody, why would I not put them in a digital form for other people to hear? Because like I said, everything I do, I want it to be for a purpose. Bigger than me. To help my fellow brothers and sisters in this floor of existence. In this game that we're in. Do I give it for free? Fuck yeah. Because you're worth it. Because you're worth it. And I think about it. So like I said, I talked about Alexis Ren the other day. And I watched that podcast. The podcast was for free. And I got so much from it. It was Thanksgiving. And I was leaving. I was hanging out with some people. And she told me about it. And so I was like, you know, whatever. On my way home from where I was at, I listened to it. And like, I just... Her story was awesome, and like, it connected to me. And so like, I did Instagram email or whatever, and just whatever. Who knows if she got it or not? I don't know. I don't care. I like to try and, especially if I gave a decent amount of time, attention, and focus to something, I do want to reach out and just say thank you for you doing now kind of what I'm doing, right? Because I think, like I said, I mean, you don't need it. I don't need validation, but I like it. And it's not that I like it. It makes me, like I said, it helps me keep going. When the time gets tough sometimes, or I don't want to talk, I don't want to speak, and that's never now. I just love to talk. Which is super weird to hear me say that I love to talk, I love to speak. And you don't know me from the past. If you knew me from the past, if you knew me, you would understand. And maybe I talked off a few of my buddies, like would talk like crazy to them, but I was more comfortable with them, right? But like, even in my family, I didn't talk much. Like, ask any of them. Like, I did not talk. And now, you know, my little brother, I talk to him a lot. But when we do talk, like when we get in those comfortable, like, we'll talk, even though it's once a year, you know, we'll talk hours, you know, about everything. You know, I'm just comfortable. And now I'm more comfortable. Like, if I get that okay. If I get that window, I'm going to talk your ear off. Like, I'm a lot. But I'm also learning that there's scenarios where people don't want that. Especially with women. Especially with anyone. A lot of people just want to be heard. They need to be heard. And so I'm learning, like, this is me hearing myself. I don't technically need someone else to hear me. Even though in... The things that I'm doing, technically, if one person watches the video, then they're hearing me. But I don't really care because I watch my own video. I don't look at anything. I don't care. I don't care how many views I get. Like, I don't care. I don't look at it. It's not about the views. Like, it's not. Like, it shouldn't be. And I don't get why it would be. Other than unless you're chasing money and you're trying to get, like, a high, whatever. I don't know. Whatever. To each his own. There's no right or wrong. But, for me, like, I don't have time to, like, look at stuff. And so me and a woman talked about, what are we, who, so yeah, so she's fire. And we talked about it, she's like, yeah, she goes, I catch myself scrolling at night. And like scrolling through the feeds, you know, and it's like, and she even said, she's like, and then I'm like, why am I doing this? Like, well, I don't care really. Like, but like you just get such, I don't know either, but everything is made for you to scroll, the scroll action or the swipe right or left. And I talked about this programming many, like, a year ago. I talked about how everything is the same action. YouTube, you're scrolling. Boom. Like, especially if you have a PC, everything is exactly the same, the way it works. So everything is the same action. A Netflix, all of it. Like, the way that it scrolls, it's all intertwined. And it gets you into the habit of scrolling through your life. And scrolling down, up to down. And trying to find something to watch, you know, trying to give yourself time, attention, and focus to something. And it's like these subtle little things that they're patterns. And obviously the CIA and the government and marketing and all, they spent tons and tons and tons of research and money on how to grab your attention, how to program you, how to program sheep, how to get what they want, to steal your time, attention, and focus, which is your highest power, which is your worth, and it doesn't involve money. I'm telling you, money is the byproduct. Money is the glass or the bag over the head or the sheep over the eyes or I don't know, sheet over the eyes or whatever. Like, money is just what we see tangibly. But that's the biggest distraction in itself, is that the money system itself is false. It's inflated. We should have crashed. We should have crashed 5 years ago. We should have had a 2008 5 years ago. But they blasted us through it. And, you know, maybe even more than 5 years ago, but we should have dropped a while ago. And they overinflated it, and they threw money in and kept it burning, kept it alive. And so kind of what's going on now is it's going to drop at some point. They could either do it in the fall. I see it happening in the fall, right before the new year, before the election year. I don't know. And then so they could, this is conspiracy, but it's not a conspiracy. It's going to happen at some point. But they're going to cause a problem, and then they're going to fix the problem. You know, that's the oldest trick in the book, is cause the problem and then come and fix it. Which I could do that too. And that's a prime ego check. Yeah, that's a fucking problem. I could do that. I do use high level manipulation tactics in the things that I do. And honestly, I do. Say you never watched my content, say I never threw in an idea, then you would never know, right? You would be comfortably numb for the rest of your life. But being that I speak the way that I speak, I'm obviously coming in here, shattering your reality, giving you new perspectives that is causing a fucking problem. Whether that's positive or negative, you could perceive it as negative. Because I'm walking in, I'm showing you there's another way when you're comfortably numb. You don't want any better. You don't want any different. You're okay with the life the way it is, right? And maybe you want to be dead your whole life, or you want to, you're okay with living the way that you've been. And I looked at that because I went through a talk the other day. The first time I came back that day, I was like, man, did everything I do, is it pointless? Because I could perceive it where it's like, if I never would have changed, I wouldn't have known any better. I wouldn't have known there was another way. I never would have been this happy. I never would have felt joy and bliss like I do on my own. I would have never been confident in myself. I would have never been wanting or learning that I'm something and worth something, and then, you know, taking progressive steps to love myself better and become more confident in myself and heal myself and heal my traumas so that I don't put those on a potential mate or my kids, if I have kids or if I, you know, whatever, went through that route and heal all that stuff. So, but I could have done what I'd done in the past forever. Like literally, it was fine. But actually no, because now the same thing, at some point I would have had to move out of this house. But, and I knew that, but I was just, you know, whatever. Like, I think inevitable, whatever word that is in the term that I'm trying to say it. And I'm not going to keep trying it because it's embarrassing. I don't know why I do this to myself. I can't even sound it out. That's the biggest part, like in my head. I can't sound it out. I talk to myself, but I can't sound it out. So whatever. So I think it kind of comes around the destiny idea, predetermined idea. But like, I think predetermined, like no matter what, at some point I would have had to leave this place, right? Like no matter what route I went, one could have went left, one could have went right. I could have continued to stay on the path that I was at. But I don't even know how that looks. I don't even, like, as I look back, I'm like, I have no idea what I would have done for the last three years. I don't see it. I don't see how it could have been any different. I've tried to look at it, at least in 90%. Because in that 1%, it could have been, I could maybe perceive it, but not really. Not really. No, I couldn't. And I would hate to, because I would like to imagine that idea. I would have loved to imagine that idea, but I can't. Because it wasn't meant to be yet. So So I look at that where it's like, no matter what, it would have happened this way for me. It had to. Otherwise, it wouldn't have. So honestly, it wouldn't have existed if I had this notion from the beginning that when the time came, I realized that whether I would have been dead or not dead, I felt like it was my last chance to change when I started this journey. And I just a deep yearning in my soul was like, this is the last chance to change. If you don't change now, like, you're dead. Like, it's over. It's over. Like, you don't have a chance. And so that, it didn't really, it honestly, that didn't help me choose to change. It really didn't. It was kind of just the effect of when I started to change and give myself time, I felt like if I wouldn't have, I would have died. It would have been over for me. Whether I would have lived the rest of my life, but it would have been just dread. It would have been a zombie, you know. I would have never been happy. And, I just would have been comfortably numb for the rest of my life until I died from self-inflicted life choices. Like being fat or being overweight or having a heart attack or this or that, you know. And, life. And so, like, when I changed, like, everything started changing in me. Like, the way I felt changed. I feel like I'm 18, 19 years old again. I think like I'm that again. Yet I still have wisdom and stuff that causes me to not, like, ultimately go chase 19 and 20 year olds. Because I don't, even though, like, my brain capacity is of that, well, I'm getting to start out again. And where, like, I missed out on that type of life of living that idea. Because I was straight into, I went to college and I worked, you know, three jobs while going to college, or two jobs. And I was always working and studying. And then straight into work, you know, when I got out of college, I just continued to just keep working and cutting grass and then working other jobs too while cutting grass. Like, so I never had time to stop. And, you know, I'd go on vacation every now and then, I'd go hang out with buddies, or we would climb, or we would do this, but it was just, I never lived like the college kids lived. Well, everyone went to college, like, I stayed at home, I stayed in Hendersonville, whatever, and worked, and then went to college, too. And, like I said, it was, I always like the idea of, like, going to college and living with these kids, like, when I was young, and, like, experiencing what they experienced, but I never got to experience it. And I'm not regretting it now, but I thought it would have been fun, right? Things would have been different. I would have done this, done that, maybe been more able to find myself, maybe, but maybe not, you know, but maybe not. And, but I you know what, honestly, I probably was jealous, like, when everyone was at UT and I wasn't. And I was like, man, I don't know, this is just the path for me. And I'd go hang out with them a little, you know, I'd go up there and hang out with them and stuff, but I couldn't even hang with them either. Like, those kids were partying rough and I couldn't do it. But you know, and like I said, it was better for me not to, you know, honestly, in the long run, it was better for me to not live that lifestyle, because I would have gotten in trouble. And at some point. And so I did live my life where I worked all the time, and it kept me out of trouble. Like, I mean, I don't have kids. I never had kids. Like, so I look at it where it's like, I stayed out of trouble for sure. Work kept me busy. And then, like, when you're working, like, you never see females anyways. So, like, in my field, like, you hardly ever did, or if you did, it was just whatever. Like I said, me being that I had, like, zero self-worth, and I didn't want to get in trouble. Like, I always had this idea of, I don't want to get in trouble. I don't get it, man. But that was just broken from a child, I guess, where it's like, I always got in trouble. And I was always bad and naughty. And I every time I say the word naughty, dude, it turns me into a fucking child. Every single time. every single time. And it's like I never want to put that on a kid. I never want them, whether it's my kid or somebody else's kid, I never want them to think that I look down on them or ashamed of them or gonna punish them for an act that they do. Like there's a way to explain it and there's a way to bypass it. Oh my goodness. Today was crazy. It was the weirdest thing I've ever seen. But, yeah, so I just trying to live the best I can. And, like I said, dude, I love talking. I love speaking because I just didn't do it. Like, and so now, like, to hear yourself talk, and that you have a voice, and that I don't need anyone else to hear me. It just gives me a feeling of like, this is what I needed all along. Was to speak and for me to speak and hear myself talk. And not in a, you know, not in a weird way, but like, to speak my feelings, speak my thoughts, and then to accept them. They're not good, they're not bad, but it is me. And that I love and accept me in whatever it is that I do and say. And like I said, if I don't like it, I can change it. But if I don't speak it, it's plain make-believe, right? Then it's not real. And then that's where like those real, you can't take accountability for your actions if you bypass your actions. If you don't acknowledge that the actions that you're taking are real. And for me, I had to speak it. And even if I'm, and what's crazy is I don't have to speak all of them, right? So I can speak like this and it's bringing up stories in my life that I'm not going to talk about, or things that are actions that I've done, but that's acknowledged enough for me, because I'm attaching the imaginary thing, event in my life, to the words that are coming out of my mouth, and that's enough, because it's taking away the emotion, it's taking out like the negativeness of it, and then I'm looking at it from at that point. So I'm doing multiple things when I'm talking, like now I'm going through multiple scenarios and all this stuff. Like I said, it's really multifaceted. But yeah, today was cool, man. And I don't really know how long I'm gonna talk. I wanna make this video short so I can compact the video. But I may make it longer, who knows. But yeah, like I don't know, man. It's been fun. It's been fun, and I guess I need to, I'll be busy tomorrow and the next day for sure, and then after that I can take a breather for a second, which I'm, you know, I look at my life and it's like I'm busy, but I guess I need to start like going crazy over what I gotta do here to get rid of all this stuff or whatever. Even though I have a little bit of time, I may not have as much time as I think, and but I've just been trying to delegate time in my subconscious to like, how am I gonna do this? What am I gonna do? And what's the best avenue for me? And then again, like I said, it sucks because it's like you're walking away from your whole existence of life that you built up until this point. Again, you know, well, another part of it. Well, I walked away from the old version of me and built this new version. And then now the external, now it's time to deal with the external part of that, which is tools and lawnmowers and boats and three-wheelers and kayaks and more tools. And like, how do I do this? Because no matter where I go, like if I don't have somewhere, I can't carry all this around with me until I find a new place to go. So it's like, what do I do here? Like, how? What's the best avenue? And then I have two different aspects. I have tools, and then I have art, you know? And it's like, no matter what, my art, I'm keeping that shit, because I'm proud of it. I'm proud of it. The only thing in my life that I've ever been proud of is my art. And the stories in it, and whom I made it for, which was me first, and then the other party that's involved that came out of nowhere. I don't know where, but whatever inspiration or muse that I had, like, that art is the thing that I've loved the most ever in my life, for some reason. It's because it was real. It was real emotion. And it was for the first time I really trusted myself. Like, no matter what it looked like on the external, internally, like, I'm all in. I was all in always. And it's like, I literally gave myself time. Every single piece of art that I made, like, I can't explain it. It's everything. It's all of me in every piece of art that I have. Like, there's nothing I could have done more, and there's nothing I could have done less. Like, it was exactly all of me in every piece of art that I've ever made. And I can't explain it any other than it was everything. If I had a vial of something, of my life, every piece of art, I poured that vial out on top of it every time. And so, like, I'm so fucking proud of it. Now, and the whole point is, like, I've never given away any of my art that is, I've given away some of it, but those pieces were for other people, I promise you. They were exactly for whom I gave them to. I made them exactly for them. I can't explain it other than it is what it is. But then, like I said, all my art that involves a huge love story or whatever story of my love for myself, and like, I haven't given any of those away, and I don't even know, like, it's so long ago, like, it was so much information, like, it's actually really fucking overwhelming, like, how much art I made. It's fucking over, it's overwhelming for me, and I made it. Imagine somebody else looking at it going, this is fucking crazy. I'm going, yeah, well, yeah, yeah, I'm the one who made it. I'm the one who has to be confident about it. Are you serious? You know how hard that is? To continue to make it, understanding what the fuck it looks like. Psychotic? Yeah. Yeah. It looks crazy. I can't help it. Because, like, it's just tied to me too. Like, it's just the way it had to be. I didn't force anything. That's the one thing, the DFI. I didn't force anything. And I made sure. Because I hate forcing anything, especially in my art. Because it looks like shit to me. Anytime I try and force something in my art, it looked like shit. The only thing that didn't was when I drew the vines on my truck. And I didn't force those. I honestly didn't know that they were going to happen, and then when I saw it, then I just went with it. I was like, yeah, this is good. And that's really the only detailed stuff I've ever done, was the vines on my truck and the leaves. And then when I did the leaves, I just knew they were going to be a leaf, but then I moved my hand in the shape of a leaf, you know, and they came out exactly what it was. But as far as me forcing any hard structure in my art, no, I've never done it. Maybe spray painting, it's not really a force. I just felt myself and drew what I felt. But then everything else, it just kind of did what it did. Like, and that's why I like doing my art. And I talked to a girl who knows what she's going to paint. And I told her, I was like, dude, this is crazy to me. I was like, I can't even imagine anything to put in my art. Because, like, I can't see the hard edges. I can't see the straight lines. They don't exist for me. Like, they really don't. I could put a box or square or something, but even then, like, I don't get it. Like, it's not in my realm of understanding how people Bob Ross it, how people do art with putting things in it, like it doesn't make sense to me. It's not that I'm not capable of doing it, I just don't want to do it. I don't want to use the brain power to do it, like it's not me. It makes me uneasy to even try to force something in it. It's almost like if I write the symbol IVEA, you know, with the X in it, like I have to do it in a way, like there's differences when I do it. I can't even explain it because it's a simple letters and an X. But depending on how I do it, it's a totally different thing. It's a different thing. Like it's totally different. I can't explain it. Like it's, but that's about it. Like that's about the only hard thing that I put in my art or have, and I haven't done it in a while. But dude, I love painting. And it's so crazy because I check myself too a lot of times, where like I said, it's the process that I get off in, you know, and I enjoy and I learn and I think. And then, like, once it's done, like, I don't even give a fuck. Like, I just pack up my art and, like, put it in my truck and, like, I don't even look at it again. And, like, like I said, I have all this art in my house that I've made over the last year and a half or whatever. Almost 2 years. And, like, I've looked at it a few times, literally. And, but I trust it. You know, I love it. I'm proud of it. Even if I haven't seen it in a half a year. Since the day I made it, I still love it completely. Like there, when I see it again, like everything rushes back. That whole night, that whole experience, the music rushes back to me. Like I've never had memories like that. Other than like that 1% of my life. Now, but that's what I said, like since I've changed, like before I couldn't remember a lot of stuff, unless they were emotional. But now, that's the thing, is like I was so comfortably numb, I didn't have emotion, right? And so I could never recall things because I had no emotion in them. And now it's like every time I create something, or you know, over the last 2 years or something, when I had interaction with a certain person or something, like I always formed so much emotion in them. Like, so now I those memories and those experiences always pop up in my head, and they're just so real. Like, they happened today and or yesterday, you know? Like they were just right there. Like, they're so real. And they just make me laugh because it's like, I was, so, yeah, it was so crazy. Just such a crazy amount of emotion or energy that I've never felt before. And it was like, I think of the movie, like, Driver. Like, and I've been thinking about this for a very fucking long time. But, like, that was one of, Drive. That was, like, one of my favorite movies, like, with Ryan Reynolds in it. Not Ryan Reynolds. Ryan Gosling or whatever his name is. And he, like, doesn't talk in the whole fucking movie. Like, ever. Like, ever. And like that, it was just funny to me because that's what I felt like in one interactions, kind of like it was like that. It was so weird. But the music in that movie was fire too, because like the music dictated the emotion. Like it was able to make it audible of the emotion of what was really going on. And then so I lived that life because I always had headphones in, and then my painting. So like I was literally like almost living the same thing, where the music was telling me the emotions and what was really going on, even in the silence. And that itself was confusing, because it's like, that's how I look at everything now in this world, is like, words only say so much. And then if there's zero action, but yet there's still energy, in chemistry, like, and everyone feels that, everyone. Like, not just the two people involved, but everyone else can see it and feel it, like it's tangible, it's real. It's super confusing. And then, like, that's how I kind of walk around the world now, is like, feeling the energy and the chemistry between people. And then a lot of times, like, I have to dumb it down, or I have to not accept it. I'm trying not to infringe on people's free will. So I don't force things. When I can force them all day long and get whatever it is, but I don't evidently want it. But I don't know. In a lot of scenarios now. But that's just because I'm already got a dog collar around my neck, I guess. And I've not been able to take it off. But I felt like that my whole life. Like, this is the way I live. It is what it is. I get hyper focused. And it is what it is until I'm not focused anymore. But I got a lot of stuff going on. I'm trying to just figure this out. Like I said, my life is pretty fucking stressful. It's pretty fucking stressful. And I really don't know how I manage it the way I do. I really don't. Like, as I look at it and I look at the way things have gone, like, there's been times when I've had negative, so much fucking negative money in my bank account. And yet, I'm still fucking playing. I'm still happy. I'm still smiling. And, like, just like, it's fucking gonna work out. And then it does. Like, it does. Like, it makes zero fucking sense to me. It just makes zero sense. And it's like, I'm just not stressing about any of it. And it's like, I don't get it. I don't fucking get it. Like, I always have food. Always have water. I always have whatever it is that I need, and it makes zero fucking sense. Like, on the verge of, like, maybe I am crazy, but I can't be fucking crazy because everything is working out. Even if it doesn't, even if from other people's perception it doesn't look like it, but I think it does look like it's working out. That's what's so fucking crazy. Is like I said, when a woman came up to me, I was talking to a woman the other day, and she's like, "What do you fucking, like, what do you do?" And people ask me that all the time. They're like, "What do you even do?" And I laugh because I live the life of like, no one actually ever really knew what I did. No one really ever came to work with me. Only a few people ever, I would ever let, you know, a couple roommates would work with me once every 10 years, you know. Or one dude would come do a job with me, and then, you know, I pretty much just murdered him that day, and then he never came back. That was the funniest. So we tore down like 250 foot of fence. And I told him, I said, "Hey," I was like, "Man," I was like, "when we go to work, like, we're not leaving till we're done. Like, and it's not gonna be hard. You're gonna do the easy stuff. Like, and we're gonna do all the hard stuff, but we just need a laborer to give us what we need, you know? So that's how we can be efficient and fast. Just get stuff in our hands, you know?" And so we poured down this whole fence to about probably 250 feet of it. And built, you know, dug new holes, planted all the posts, put up 250 foot of fence, and like we left there probably 8:30 or 9 o'clock at night, and and by the time like we got 4 or 5 minutes down the road, like he was fucking passed out, and this is like in Clarksville, so we had to drive all the way back home to Hendersonville, and I had like my trailer filled with fence. And it was a long ass day, maybe a 16-hour day or something like that. And you know, I was tired too, man. But like, that's how I worked all the time. Like that shit was regular to me. You know, not a big fucking deal. And like, that's easy day. You know, that's 16 hours. Who cares? But I look at it because it's like, that's the way I worked all the time. Like, that's what we did. Like, we pushed it. And like I said, I really destroyed my body. So like, I really fucked my body up, man. And I was kind of getting worried about it. Because as I was getting older, I was like, dude, I'm fucked. Like, I'm going to be destroyed by the time I'm 50. But I've healed my body so much in the last 3 years. Like, my body is good. Like, I'm an 18-year-old again. And that's with, like, murdering my body since I was young. Not caring about it. Physical labor always. And, like, and so that's kind of, that is one reason why I don't really care about, like, if I have extra fat on me or something like that right now. Because, like, dude, my body is still trying to rest and recover and heal from the stupid shit that I did my whole life for a fucking dollar. And, it's like, unless you're in a blue-collar field, like, you don't understand that shit. You could do, you do it mentally, which is just as bad, because the amount of stress, mental stress, you know, cause ulcers and all this kind of stuff. But, yeah, dude, I was fucked. My body was fucked. And, like I said, I've recovered and healed from it, and, doesn't mean I still don't get cramped up and hurt a little bit, but, it's nothing like it used to be, dude. I would come home every day, and I would literally park my truck and sit in my truck for, like, 30 minutes to an hour before I would go in the house, because I hurt that bad every fucking day. Like, I had to gain the strength to get up and out of my truck, fall out of my truck and get in the fucking house. Like, my body was fucked. And, like I said, my... And right before I started to change, like, the year before that, my hip would give out. Like, I'm, like, 34 years old, 33 years old. Like, my hip would just give out. And, and I would almost fall. And there was many times, like, I'd be carrying tile, like, boxes of tile and stuff, and, like, my hip would give out. I don't know how I didn't fall and hurt myself, you know, because then I'd catch it. Thank goodness I was halfway strong in the other parts of my body. And, but I was destroyed, man. I was destroyed, and that's why I was fat. It's like my body was breaking down. Like, cause I abused it, and I didn't, care for it. And even now, I'm not as good, you know. I'm still not, like, treating it, like, the best. But it's a lot better when I'm resting, and I'm not working so hard. I'm not sun up to sun down. I'm not killing myself anymore, you know. And that's what I'm saying. Like, that's why I'm justifying a lot of what's going on in my life. It's like... Yeah, it looks like I'm lazy, it looks like I'm not doing this, but it's like, dude, I'm healing from a lifetime of me fucking neglecting myself and abusing myself and mutilating my body. And so, like, I had to go extreme with it. You know, and it doesn't really bother me that much anymore. But, like, during the process, dude, I was so... All the time, I was like, man... I would give myself so much shit because, like, dude, I feel so lazy. I felt so bad. Like, I flipped the house 2 years ago. That took me, like, 4 or 5 months, and it shouldn't have. It should have took me a month, really, 4 weeks. And honestly, like, I probably could have done it in two. But, like, I would go, like, one day a week for a couple of hours, dude. It was embarrassing. Fucking embarrassing. So embarrassing. Because, like, I knew I needed to get the job done, but, like, it was after my mom died, and, I just didn't give a fuck. Like, I really didn't want to do it. I did it first, and I thought my mental was good, because it was about 6 or 7 months after my mom died. I was like, you know, I got this shit. I'm good. But no, I wasn't. I wasn't good at all. And, it was fucking embarrassing. I'm glad... I had someone who loved me. We had good... I was embarrassed. I'm still embarrassed at how long it took. But he told me, he was like, dude, you just need to work on your mental health. You know, like... And he gave me a good break about it. And I just kept giving myself those days. And I actually watched myself, too. It was a huge learning process, because I would drive all the way out to this job in fucking Antioch. And like, on the days that I didn't feel good, nothing would get done. And then the days that I felt good, I laid the whole fucking house. All the laminate flooring in the whole house, almost the whole house, in one fucking day by myself. Like, 1,500 square feet. Because I felt good. And, but then, like... I would go out there and I wouldn't get shit done on other days when I didn't. And so, like, I'm actually really, really fast at what I do, but I have to be in the headspace to do it. Like, if my body tells me no, and I go out there and force it, then nothing's gonna happen. And that was the biggest lesson, I think, during that time, that number one, I needed to focus on myself. That mental is very important, where I used to just push myself through it and, like, you know, stop being a pussy, you know, stop being a sissy, you know, whatever. And but then, like I said, I gave myself time, having to do the opposite of what I always did. And embarrassing, hell yeah. Embarrassing, hell yeah. And I felt so bad. I still do. Like I said, I still kind of feel bad how long it took. Like, I'm embarrassed of it. But it all worked out in the end. And it's past me. But, like, yeah, and then when my mom was in the hospital, like, I was working on another flip. That shouldn't have took me that long at all. But then, like, then she passed away, and, like, or we had conversations on the phone while I'm over here painting this house, like, working on this remodel. And that one took too long, because, like, I would just stand there in the house, like, and then my painting was shit or slow. And it's so crazy, because I always use music. So, like, I remember that house I painted listening to Kiara, something, whatever. And yeah, Kiara, K-I-A, or Kara, I don't know. Her music was crazy, and it's, like, kind of depressing. And some of it's depressing. Some, I don't know. She's an amazing singer, but I listened to her whole CD, like, and she pushed me through. And then, like I said, like, I always use music to push me through. Like, even sad songs or whatever, like. But yeah, dude, I've been through a lot just in the last couple of years. Like, this journey, like I said, it's not been easy at all. It's a stab to the heart every fucking day. It really has been. But it makes it so much sweeter in the end. Because it's like, you get there, and, like, you get past it, and you're like, well, it wasn't that bad. I was just being a little bitch, you know? I was just being a little bitch about the whole thing. When I could have, like, you know? But for the first time in my life, I realized that all those lessons, they could have happened faster. But I had to do it exactly the way I did it. I had to suffer in it. Self-suffering. Because I chose it. Like, there was no external anything forcing me to feel this way or think this way, really. It was me. It was my choice at all stops. And everything that I've went through in my life, like I said, was me. It was me in the way I chose to hit it, or the way I chose to quit it. You know, like, it was all me. And I feel bad about it, you know. But there's nothing I can do about it now. And like I said, I like, last night I woke up, or the night before, I don't know, man. But, like, I, you know, and I feel like I need to apologize to somebody. But it's like, I'm thinking about, like, why or what do I apologize for? I just feel bad. But then half of me is like, but for what? Like, and I'm thinking about it, because it's like, I don't know. I could have done things different. I just didn't know any better. And I'm embarrassed because of it. And it's like, I feel sorry, because I don't know maybe the other person's life or perspective, or the way that, and I, you know, I never wanted to hurt anybody. That was not what was intended. I just didn't know any better, and I was wrapped up in myself, not being good enough, right? And so I feel shitty about it. I feel very shitty about it. But I don't know, like, other than that, like, how do I say sorry for what, you know? For being a douchebag, I guess. I don't know. It's hard to explain. Like, how do I say I'm sorry for, like, and this is what I talked about the other day. I was like, what am I supposed to be sorry for? Like, I get, and this is kind of like a wrapped around tree thing. I'm sorry for the way I feel. I'm sorry for using someone as inspiration. I'm sorry for my body doing this or doing that, or me loving somebody or inspired by somebody. I can't help it. I wish I could. Not really, but if it hurts somebody negatively, then you almost look at it with like, I just don't want the other person to hurt. I don't know how to fix it because I don't even know what the problem was. There wasn't any information. I didn't have any information. And it's not the other person's fault at all, really, or my fault. It's just the way the situation played out. But I do feel sorry. And like I said, I woke up in the middle of the night last night going, I need to be sorry. Or I feel sorry. I felt like I'm sorry, but at the same time, it's like, but what am I sorry for? And if I can't even speak the words of what I'm sorry for, and this definitely isn't the avenue for me to apologize to somebody, at all. But I could just assume maybe I'm sorry for not speaking more of my truth with the physical mouth. Sorry for leaving. Sorry for being overwhelmed. Sorry for, I guess, being scared. I was scared. It was overwhelming feelings. I'm not sorry about, man, that's what's so crazy. I don't know, man. Because it's already done. And so you look at it in every aspect of my life. It's like, even in the situations, like, I don't know what I'm sorry for. Because there's nothing I can do about it now. I didn't want anyone to get hurt. But I don't even know if anyone did get hurt because I don't have information to prove no one told me anything. I have no idea. I could assume, I guess, possibly. But then again, no one told me anything. I have no idea. No one gave me any clue, really. From my perspective. And so that was the battle. Like, do you even care at all? So I never really felt, other than the extreme energy. But then again, I guess I should have trusted myself more and based that everything else in my life was true. And that was too, but that was, I guess, my biggest lesson. So I don't know how to apologize for, like, I don't know. But I know now, maybe. So I don't know. And then I don't know what to do about it because I don't even know. But yeah, man, it was just an overlooming idea last night of, like, I'm sorry. Like, I woke up out of bed thinking, like, I'm sorry. But then instantly going, I can't even explain what I'm sorry for. I'm just sorry. You know, when I look about it, I think about it because it's like, you know, because like even like, I think about it, was like, if you don't know what you're sorry for, then how can you be sorry? Right? But it's like, I can't explain it in words. Like, I don't know. I'm trying to. Because, like, when you're admitting that you're sorry, like, but it's like, I didn't even know the other side of the story. I didn't get any clues other than, like, maybe I feel like I let you down or let somebody down. And I hate that feeling. I hate it so much because that's what I lived my whole fucking life. And then it makes me feel like I'm not good enough. And that's what I'm saying. That was the whole gist of it. It's like I was just like in this energy of like, I'm not good enough. Like, not, I'm not seeing anything in return, really. I'm not getting that. And that's just kind of what I felt. But maybe that was my perspective with the old programming that I was still trying to break down. And so you look at it, and it's like, so it's like, I don't even know what I could be sorry for. Because like I said, like, I feel sorry, but I don't. But I do. But then there's nothing I can do about it. I don't know. It's the most confusing shit in the world. It's the most confusing shit in the world. And then I look at this too. Like, then with many interactions with people. It's like, I don't get it. I don't get it. Because I feel sorry. But then at the same time, it's like, but this is the issue. This is what I feel that's weird. And it's not that I'm justifying anything. But it's like, it almost brings me to the idea of every time I do something for myself, I feel fucking sorry about it. Every time I love myself, I feel sorry about it, because then I feel like I'm hurting somebody else. I'm neglecting somebody else. Like, this is the stain that was on me since I was little. So like literally the act of me sticking up for myself, of giving myself time, attention, and focus, or me walking away from somebody because I'm not getting ideas or knowledge or wisdom or a word or how somebody feels, like, I still feel negative about it when I leave. And I do. I always do. It makes me want to throw up right now. I feel like I'm neglecting the other person because I took away what I was giving. And it makes me feel like shit. I don't know how to overcome that. Like, you don't understand the deep abandonment wounds that I have that intertwines those emotions of every time I leave somebody. Like, literally for fucking 5 minutes, it hurts. Or I question it. Like, it's the fucking worst. It kills me. It hurts every time. And I've gotten so much better at it. But, like, before, that's why I never liked saying goodbye. I hate saying goodbye. Like, I fucking hate it. Because it kills me every time. Like, literally, every time. Like, it fucking murders me. And then, like, the act of me leaving is, like, it's that pull string. It's like, well, you know, like, I hope that they don't hate me that I'm leaving, you know, or something like that. Like, I feel fucking bad. Like, I, especially if I like you or love you or whatever, or want to give you time. Like, because then I feel like I'm, like I'm choosing to leave you. And I was like, I'm not. Like, I would stay here forever if I could with you, you know? But that's just me. And something's wrong with me, I guess. I don't know. If I like you, I like you. I don't know. I don't get it. But like I said, I'm broken, I guess. Yeah. Not really, but the ideas in me were just so, I just don't know. And so, like, a lot of times, like, I try and, like I said, it's hard for me to leave people. And so what I really like is, like, when there's structure around things, or the other person says, well, I gotta go. And I'm like, fuck yeah, good, I get it. Cool, you gotta go, now I can leave. Because, like, just the act of me leaving you fucking kills me. It fucking kills me every time. Like, because I never want to abandon people, even though I do. But it's like, because it hurts so fucking bad. Because that's what I felt my whole life. But it was me abandoning myself, you know, that was the greatest stain. Even though me saying that is kind of just a cover up for my whole life, right? Just me taking responsibility when a lot of times it was other people that abandoned me. But whatever. I'm not gonna talk about shit. That's just the way I chose to deal with it. And you learn that little as a kid, I put death in there too, especially when you're a kid, because you learn the loss of somebody is abandonment. If you have that abandonment stain early on, because it's the same emotional signature almost, the loss of, right? And you're a fucking child. You don't understand the bigger picture, I guess. And that's why I said kids are smart. Kids are smart and kids are simple, but there is some stuff that they need to be taught the right way of early. But for a lot of things, like, the simple answer is love, right? And that's what kids have. They have innocence and love. And kids are smart. And kids know the right answer. And it's a totality of the whole system of killing people for land, killing people for resources. Like, we don't need any of that. Like, there's no reason ever, if we all work together, that we can't have everything that we need to survive. We may not have nice shit, but basic needs, basic food, basic water, basic health, is possible. Work or purpose is possible. But like I said, as far as the books go, like, there's always killing, there's always this, like, but now is the greatest time that we can do it without all that shit. For the first time in history, it is possible because of the technology and how we can use it. To actually have a society that is good. That we don't kill each other. We don't rob each other. We have everything we need. All basic needs. And then we have purpose. And we are living. Each individual person is alive and not a zombie. And it's possible. It's possible. Not everyone will want to do it. But it is possible. And a lot of, like, me and Dude talked about it today was like, because I told him, I was like, everyone's watching other people live. You know? And that's what the social media is. And a lot of people are living, you know, they're out. But then again, they're like, they're watching their kids play soccer. The adults aren't playing soccer. You know, like, so they're watching another person live life. And, but they're not living to the max, right? Or to the most capability that they can, you know, because we got to work all the time and they're not living during that time, they're just working, performing, so the kids can live, or the kids can experience this. And now, like, you're locked down and you're stuck in this cycle and you got to go 9 to 5 every day and all this stuff. And so I said, I don't know the right answer per se for the rest of the world. But for me, like, that's my goal, is I'm going to get to the point where I'll continue to be doing what I'm doing, which is living as much as possible. And then, like, in my jobs, in my work, like, I'm making them a living function. And then I'm the one experiencing my life. I'm not watching football. I'm not watching basketball. I'm not watching movies all the time. You know, I may watch a movie every now and then, but I don't. I'm living. I'm experiencing. I'm creating my own experience in life. I'm not looking towards other people and watching them and jealous. Or, I wish I had that, or I wish I had this. And in some instances, maybe I do that still. The hope for something, or the hope for the partner. I mean, then we can create kids, and then I can live with my kids and grow up with them and teach them and stuff like that. But I don't know. I'm probably gonna kill this pretty soon so I can speed this video up. But I don't know. Like I said, I woke up last night just feeling like I'm sorry. And I don't know how to apologize, because I feel like both parties don't really, we don't need to apologize. I feel like we just need to come together and communicate. And not even communicate, honestly, but just just be together. And that will be enough. And start anew. And I think that's what, so like, me and my brother didn't talk for 2 years. For 2 years. Or however long. My mom died, and then maybe like September. Yeah, in September. September 15th is when my mom's birthday was. I was out of town. I went out of town, did the harmonic egg, came back that Friday. We kind of got into it, and then a few texts, and we haven't talked since then. Until like a month ago. And then I got to go to the kids' soccer practices today and yesterday. Man, I love those kids so much. But it was just amazing, like, I had my glasses on because I knew I was going to cry. And I'm not embarrassed to cry. At all. I mean, I cry in restaurants all day long, I don't care. But I just didn't want to break. But like when a 5-year-old you haven't seen, he just says your name and just runs to you. Man. Like, that was the price. I had to pay to find myself. then like that reward of like it all worked out, it had to be that way, and yet that little kid loves you to death and accepts you and knows no different. Like, I'm still Cody. And it sucks I didn't see him for 2 years. It sucked every day. It was the worst. It was the fucking worst. It's the worst. Man, it was the worst. But yeah, when he runs up to you and hugs you with the hugs of 1,000 hugs. Unconditional love. I don't know. It's just everything else goes away. Everything else just goes away. Like, the past doesn't matter anymore. Or the time you miss with that kid doesn't matter anymore. Like, who cares? Who cares about the past? Like, no. You don't have to go through it again. You don't ever have to miss that long again with them. And it was unconditional love the whole time. It was always unconditional love from both parties the whole time. Holla. Love y'all. Peace.
Need your love.